Hi, my name is Victor Sain, and today I want to show you 5 common ways to fix the dreaded triangle of death on a Prius.
Insanely cool cars, tool reviews, and auto repair videos.
If you're experiencing the triangle of death, the first and most common way, and the most likely to succeed, is replacing the entire hybrid battery assembly. Now, there's several places that you can call that some of them will even come out and change your assembly at your house or your place of business, wherever your vehicle is. Unfortunately, this is also the most expensive way to fix this. Number two is much less expensive, much more affordable, also much more dangerous, and that is replacing these bus bars. There are a bunch of them. Yours probably don't look as nice and shiny and clean as these do, because I've just replaced all these. Let me show you what one of them looks like. They look like this, and they'll get some corrosion here. These are fairly new, and these are the updated bus bars. These are used. You can find a link to a pack of these in the description of the video below. When I replace them, and there's codes for individual blocks, I don't just replace the ones that are on the individual blocks that have a code set. I replace all of the bus bars as a full set. And they usually look a lot more corroded than this. Most of the time, they'll look kind of like that corrosion that you see on your 12-volt batteries for your regular cars. So you'll definitely want to wear gloves while doing that job. You want to wear gloves while doing anything to this. Nice, thick gloves. Actually, if you want to stay safe and avoid hospital visits, you'll want to avoid doing anything I do in my videos and avoid doing anything I even talk about in my videos. So number three is checking all of these individual modules, which 2 of them together are called a block. And in each module, there are 6 cells. Now, as you can see, I've numbered them here, and there are 28. What I did on this battery pack was, when I had all of the bus bars off, I took my meter and I took the probes and I tested them negative to positive, and I got 7.6 volts on every one of them. Then I left it open overnight with no bus bars on it, and I came back and I tested all of them individually again and still got 7.6 volts on each individual one. The reason I do that is because if one of these is weak, sometimes they'll do the same thing as like a 12-volt battery for a traditional car that's weak or has something wrong with it, and they'll start dropping voltage even though they got no load on them. Well, none of these dropped any voltage. Another clue is, if you've got consistently 7.6 volts or 7.8 volts, just however much charge you have in this when you start working on it, if you've got consistently that much voltage in each one of these, but you find 2 or 4 of them or 6 of them or however many of them's bad to have a completely different voltage, then that's a good clue that there may be something wrong with them. Or a few of them, you leave it for a couple of hours and you come back and you test again, and they have, a few of them have dropped voltage, but the other ones aren't dropping any voltage, then that's another clue. You can also do loaded voltage drop test, which I have a whole nother video on how to do that. But the point is that you could have a bad module or several bad modules. Those can be replaced. You can buy those separately and you can replace them. Of course, you still have to take this whole assembly out because there's bolts going through the bottom into these modules, and you can't get to those bolts without taking the whole assembly out. If you're new to this, I would suggest, instead of using a more expensive meter, and definitely don't use your fluke meter if you're new, get something like these cheap meters and use one of these cheap meters, because if you make a mistake and ruin your meter, you're not losing much with one of these cheap meters. And I will put a link in the description to one of the cheaper meters. And I'll put a link in the description to a good meter, which is a Fluke 87. Number four is the service plug. The service plug here, pull it this way, turn and pull it out, and that gives you the ability to have some measure of safety while working on the high voltage battery system. This, not only can you forget and leave it out while you're working on things and then go back and try to start the car and see if what you did fixed it and still have the triangle, because if you leave this out, you're going to have the dreaded triangle, and it's not going to show you a code saying, hey, dummy, you left out the service plug. No, it's not going to be that simple. So if you do change bus bars or you change some bad modules and you still have a triangle of death, come back here and make sure that you put the service plug back in. Now, if you put the service plug back in and you look at it and you say, well, I did put the service plug back in, you could still have a problem if you didn't grab it and push that to the right, or if you pushed it to the right, but only that far, because you got to have like click, click, two clicks, and see how it sticks out to the right over here? That's all the way in. What you're actually doing is underneath here on the service plug, there's another connector right here. And when you fold that over, that connector's just sitting there. When you push it this way, it actually goes into a plug over here and makes a connection. And this connection lets the computer know to close some contacts in a contactor in there to take the power from the high voltage battery and send it up that line to the inverter. Number five is all about the cooling fan and cooling the battery. As you have temperature sensors in here and you have this fan, and if your battery isn't getting cooled, it can set a code and turn on the triangle of death. That's if you're lucky, because if you're not lucky and it just keeps on working while it's not cooling good, it can ruin your high voltage battery. If you're lucky, you start having a cooling problem, it'll set a code, triangle of death, and then you got a chance to fix that problem. That problem usually is, number one, mostly dirty fan. First generation, second generations, and early third generations had no filter screen or anything, and the fan gets really nasty. Check out my video on how to clean the high voltage cooling fan, and you'll see how nasty this one got. Later third generations, fourth generations, and all that, and anyone that I've worked on has a filter, and the filters can get stopped up. If you've got an earlier generation and there's not a filter available, I have a link in the description of the video to a screen that goes on here if you don't have one, and to the filter material that I use for making filters. And I think my second video that I made on cleaning fans, I showed the filter that I made. The fan could be bad and need to be replaced too, so that's also included in number five. But when you have this fan out to clean it, it has a connector right here, and you can take a battery on the bench and connect it to that fan and see if the fan will actually work or not. That's the easiest way that I've come up with to test the fan to see if the fan's any good, which I always like to do when I'm cleaning the fan to make sure that I'm not putting all this back together, just a bad fan, and have to go take it all apart and change the fan. I also like to take compressed air and blow out all these crevices between the batteries when I'm doing that. And if you do have to replace the fan, do all the cleaning you can while you're doing it. Now, if you're still here this late in the video, I really, really appreciate that. I appreciate it so much, I'd like to give you some bonus material. When working on these, another thing I like to modify, besides putting extra filtration for the fan and cleaning the fans out, is I like to put something in here and glue it in place. I used a bottle cap for this to keep this open, because these do collapse. I mean, they sit down here, and you've got all this stuff here, and people are piling luggage and everything else, and it's compressing everything here, and it ends up mashing this down and closing this up. And if the air can't get out for the cooling, there's a metal hood that goes over here that directs the air into here. If the air can't get out, then the air can't get in, and you need that flow for the cooling. On the other end of this duct, it also closes up, and they've got these little humps to keep it from closing up a whole lot, but it still drops down and closes up. And when this drops down, the air, instead of going through here, starts escaping out here. And that puts the hot air here that could potentially get back into the fan, and just a circle of hot, superheated air. That's not good. So I used water bottle caps to glue in there to hold that open, because it's another same thing. You've got some material here, and the metal here, which is thin, and if people put heavy things on here, it compresses it all down and mashes this down too. And then take the heavy stuff off and the metal springs back up, but the plastic does not. Remember, this plastic has got hot air going through it all the time. And if it's compressed while it's hot, then it's going to conform to that shape. And then when it cools off, it's just going to stay compressed. In my next video, I'm going to go over some things on the inverter in the front of the car. Hey, if you like this video, you probably like our playlist on auto repairs or our playlist on tool reviews. Or maybe you'd enjoy our playlist on show cars and car shows. Till the next video, get off the couch and get dirty.